we already have all the information that we need based on what it is, right, and how to take preventive care. But if you'd like to really share more on that and also the best practices and healthcare measures to really prevent acquiring COVID.
COVID-19, it enters through the H2 receptor. The single most important thing is your oxygen saturation. It's not about how high your fever is, how much you cough, even though those are the symptoms that you feel. Lose your smell, lose your taste. Viral infection, meaning that you'll have muscle pains, joint pains, and things of that nature. I mean, that's all uncomfortable, but the single most important thing is your oxygen saturation. As long as your oxygen saturation stays above 92%, you get a pulse ox, which is something you put on your finger and it reads your oxygen level. As long as your levels are above 92 on the room air, meaning you don't need anything and you're breathing, then you're good. There's no real concern. The second issue is blood clots can form. So we've seen pulmonary embolism, even strokes, et cetera. It affects your kidneys, microthromboemboli. Without getting into the details, your blood could clot. So you want to like move a little bit, not like if you actually are sick with COVID, not like go crazy, but it is a good idea to walk a little bit, to stretch a little bit, something light, just to keep the blood flowing a little bit to prevent the blood clots. And then we see people with COVID develop a pulmonary embolism, and that's a tough situation. So down in the ICU, some of the patients have that scenario. Blood clots definitely have significantly contributed to worse people dying. Maybe the younger people most likely might have developed the PE. But, you know, that's the single most important thing is your oxygen saturation. Once you go into the hospital, like 80% of the people don't even make it to the hospital. Once you do get to the hospital, initially, if you don't need any oxygen requirements, you go to the ED. You know, you're above 65. You don't have any, you don't need any oxygen. They might send you home and give you monoclonal antibodies and have you follow up with the PMD, meaning primary medical doctor, as an outpatient. Or if you do get admitted, you don't need oxygen, then you might just be treated with supplementary treatments like vitamin D, vitamin C, et cetera, Sepacol, Robitussin, et cetera. Then once you start needing a little bit of oxygen, meaning nasal cannula, put the thing on your nose, oxygen flows. If you start to desat on that, then they might add the steroids, the remdesivir steroids. Starting to realize a higher dose of steroids is actually more beneficial depending. We've seen like HIV patients. I've seen HIV patients do well. When I admitted a patient that was an HIV, I thought she was going to be very much affected by this coronavirus because it's the immune, it's, you know, it's she has a weak immune system. But what we're saying is the cytokine storm, meaning let's dig a little bit deeper into this to really understand. So we have an immune system. Let's make it very simple. If the bad guys, meaning the bacteria, virus, whatever, comes into our body, and if we kill it, if we hit the target, you have a healthy immune system. If we don't fight, meaning we decide that killing is the wrong thing to do, and we decide that we're not going to kill these pathogens and these colonizing agents. That's what AIDS is. AIDS is when your immune system is not working properly. And so the infection takes over. So you don't die from AIDS or HIV. You die from the infections because your immune system is not able to respond appropriately to the infection. And then an autoimmune disease is terrorism. An autoimmune disease is when the immune system targets the healthy, innocent cells, which is always the wrong thing to do. So whenever you don't fight back, that's AIDS. Whenever you hit the target, that's health. Whenever you hit the innocent cells, that's an autoimmune disease like eczema, type 1 diabetes, et cetera, whole bunch of a lot of the diseases, you'll see 70 to 80% of the diseases are actually a function of a type 2 or type 3 hypersensitivity when you really understand deeply medicine. And I know it's not framed like that in a lot of medicine books, but actually that's the truth. A lot of diseases are like type 2, type 3 hypersensitivity reactions, meaning like lupus, et cetera, like meaning that an inflammatory process is the underlying, it really the immune system is at the heart of what's happening. So that understanding we can apply to COVID. So when COVID's there, what really is doing the most damage we've seen is the cytokine storm. So what that means is when the immune, so the difference between a bacteria and a virus, the bacteria goes into the bloodstream. Atypicals have a different thing. That's what I call atypical. But typically, a bacteria does not go inside the cell. A virus goes inside the cells. So you have a different type of immune response in each case. In COVID, what we're seeing is the cytokine storm, meaning the immune system of our cells is attacking the cells that are affected with COVID, but also attacking the lungs. So it's our own immune system that's creating a cytokine storm that's actually doing the damage to our own cells, that's really creating us to decompensate and go into acute respiratory distress and acute respiratory failure. So what we've seen is HIV patients, I've seen an HIV patient, they didn't really get affected by COVID that bad. Maybe they already were on antivirals, antiretroviral therapy because they're on AIDS, or maybe they just didn't mount a strong immune response, which saved them. And that's why we give steroids, and we're seeing that it's actually helping save patients. Like I've seen patients come down low dose steroids and increase their dose because they hit the ICU. Now we're going from dexamethasone 6 milligrams daily to salumedrol 125 Q6 or 8, and they really turned around like in the next day or two. Meaning you give more steroids, it's kind of suppressing the immune system to prevent it from attacking itself. And we've seen that have better outcomes. So if we have a healthy immune system that knows how to behave and how to react and interact with these different pathogens, that's in our best interest. And that just comes from being healthy, you know, overall.
That's an excellent breakdown, Dr. Nikhil. Thank you so much for sharing that with us. That's actually, again, I was able to register all of that and fully comprehend, right, at the best level. And hopefully,
you know, I appreciate everyone, it. That's what I want to do too, is I want to take what the doctor knows and make it so that way the common person can understand it. I think that's one of my strengths, is to be able to do that. And I want to really do that in the future with all the different diseases. That's one of my goals. You know, thank you for saying that. And patients I work with and families, they really appreciate that. Now, granted, it does take time. And as a doctor, you run around crazy and you're busy and you already work crazy hours. And that makes you go home even later. But me personally, I'm okay with that.